My name is Basil Hussein. I'm a PhD candidate in the School of Medicine in the Department of Molecular Biology and Genetics.
I'm Helena Zek. I'm a postdoc in biomedical engineering, the School of Medicine.
I'm Robert Shao. I'm a PhD candidate in the pharmacology department.
My story is semi-unique. I tried for two recruiting cycles. So my first recruiting cycle, I interviewed at two firms, and clearly I didn't get through. And to be honest, I hadn't put in the effort or the legwork. It's sort of just something that I did. And then the next time, I was quite dedicated to it. I joined the consulting club, got really involved, really prepared, practiced cases. And then the second time through, I felt really good, really confident. I ended up getting 5 interviews and got 2 offers. Then I accepted an offer with Deloitte in the strategy and operations in Boston. So that's where I'll be next year, in October.
Yeah, my story is very similar. I tried for about a year. So I actually interviewed with maybe 15 different companies and got a lot of rejections along the way. And recently I took it a little bit more seriously. Like I joined the consulting club, became director of communications and really got to network with folks and get to know people like these people that are very experienced with consulting, and got 3 offers in like 2 weeks. So yeah, I think it's just practice and perseverance.
Yes. Yeah, I think Basil and Helena got pretty much all of it. Mine's about the same thing, same experience too. I think I applied last year to also about 15 to 20 firms, including McKinsey, BCG, and Bain, and some smaller firms as well. And I think I got interviews from all of them and ended up getting some offers from Boutique Life Sciences, and then ended up getting McKinsey's offer. And once I got McKinsey's offer, I was like, you know, that's the place I wanted to be, and I went ahead and canceled my other interviews.
I slightly negotiated. So having multiple offers helps you, right? If I only had one, I was just going to take it and jump on it because I'm a PhD student and, you know, what value do I actually have? Those are the things that go through your head. But having another offer helped me leverage them, so it sort of get some of the things that I wanted. And I would encourage people not to be hesitant to negotiate a little bit. You know, if you have this fear in your head, like they're going to pull the offer. And the truth is, you made it through all of the interviews to the final round, and chances are they're willing to wiggle a little bit. So I would encourage people to do that and not be particularly scared by it.
I did try to negotiate.
Then.
and first I tried to get a higher salary, and they just said, we would never do that. So then I tried to negotiate my relocation. I don't know if my story is unique, but my recruiter just fell off the face of the earth. So I just had to sign the offer letter before she could get back to me. So I tried.
Well, my experience was actually a little different. I think I'd signed my contract maybe 2 days after I got the offer letter. And I actually didn't negotiate my offer in any way. I think for numerous reasons, but mainly 2 reasons. One is the package itself was already pretty good. So even if I negotiated, let's say another, I won't say the amount, but even if I negotiated, it wouldn't make much of a difference. And secondly, to me, the assets provided by the firm, the training and everything else was more important than the money itself. So
yeah.
That's why.
Yeah, I agree with that. Mm-hmm. Sure, so we were talking about this earlier, but I think, you know, everyone comes here to Hopkins during their PhD, they think they're gonna be a scientist. And I was in that boat as well, and I will tell you, I would say year 3 or 4, after you've been in the lab long enough and you sort of get a feel for what science is really about, that's when I got the inkling that there are lots of things about science that I actually liked, but there were things that I desired more. And so I wanted to work on more structured projects over a finite amount of time and really have impact. And so I wanted to see somewhere where I could consolidate my PhD skills and the things that I wanted, and consulting something that I fell into and it fit. So that's my story.
Yeah, I would say the same thing. I definitely came into the PhD with every intention of becoming a scientist or becoming faculty, but also after seeing just funding rates from NIH and NSF so drastically decreased and watching people do postdocs for like 5 or 8 years before they even got a faculty position, I just kind of decided it wasn't for me. and I wanted to look in other careers. The one thing I love about science is that you get to be creative and very independent and set your own schedule. But consulting is exciting because you maybe can shape the industry or really have a great start to the early in your career.
I actually, again, it's a little bit different because I actually applied to grad school and came into the pharmacology program thinking that I'm going to industry right after graduation. So I wasn't really interested in being a bench scientist as a career for my life. So I heard about consulting my first year, but I really didn't make up my mind until my third year when I attended the case competition. And actually, after attending a few case competitions and doing some pro bono consulting projects, and then actually recently an internship, my motivation and dedication to becoming a consultant actually become more and more strengthened throughout each experience. And I think the fact that it's fast-paced, impact-driven, challenging but very rewarding type of work, those things are the things that really attracted me to consulting.
Can I say one more thing? And I think they'll both agree with me. It's like coming here, one of the reasons why I came here is I wanted to work with talented, driven, smart people. And that's not something that I wanted to leave behind. So I wanted a really intellectually stimulating environment. And I think when you look at consulting firms and the pedigrees that people have and the caliber of person that is at these firms, I'm very happy to be going to an intellectually stimulating environment. The consulting club here at Hopkins, I would say, is a very strong consulting club. And I think one of the real advantages of joining the consulting club is the first decision you have to make is it something you're actually interested in, right? And so being part of the club gives you a lot of opportunities, whether it's information sessions from firms that recruit here at Hopkins, or how to do interviews and case interview workshops, or pro bono work that Robert actually mentioned. It allows you to sort of dip your toe into the pool and get a feel for if you actually like it. And once you make that decision, I think things become more clear. It becomes a definitive path of preparing for interviews, learning more about firms, and really honing your skills.
Yeah, I would agree with what Basil said. I think when I started to become more involved with the consulting club, I noticed a difference in how I was also interviewing at firms. And just having networked with people also helped going into the interviews.
Yeah, I think they got the important points. I think to emphasize it even more, I think the exploration part is very important, especially to young graduate students. I think in their first, second, and even third year, they should really spend time and explore different career paths before they decide which one is right for them. Because it takes a long time for most people to get one of these jobs. And so you have to really make sure that you're really interested and motivated about this type of work before you dedicate yourself to preparing for it. And I think we might cover some of the preparation steps after, right?
Yeah.
I also think a really good thing that you did was you interned with a few
right.
companies,
right, I did.
Which
yeah.
was really helpful.
Yeah, that definitely helped me decide.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I would like to emphasize is when you're a scientist and you're thinking about an alternative career path, you're nervous and you're apprehensive, and rightfully so, because you're doing something that you've never actually done. And I would say you're more valuable than you think you are, so have confidence in yourself. When I started thinking about this, I was like, am I going to be valuable? Why would they even hire me? But the point is that these firms actually have dedicated recruiting staffs to recruiting PhDs, so you are very valuable. So keep that in mind. And then beyond that, I would say you have to practice cases for case interviews. I think it's absolutely necessary to do that. And the good thing is it's a learnable skill, but it requires effort, and you have to really train yourself to do it.
And I also think, adding to that, the fit interviews are so important. So you can make a few mistakes on the case interview, but if they don't like you, they're not going to hire you. So just choosing the right stories and come across as a likable person, someone that they'd like to hang out with in the airport. It's always the airport test that they mention. So you need to take that seriously.
Yeah, I think Basil and Helena covered the case interview and the personal experience part. And I think there is one part I think more people can help themselves do more in. That's before getting even the interviews. And you can do that by case competitions, pro bono work. But I think the main thing is networking. But I would say that networking also depends on which kind of firms you're talking to. So for McKinsey, BCG, and Bain, they look at more on your experiences, your resume, your cover letter, your stories, and your personality. Whereas for boutique life sciences firms, they tend to care more about whether they know you or not. So I think you would have to decide for yourself whether you want to be a journalist or a boutique life science consultant, and then you go down each different pathway.
Unlike other jobs, consulting has sort of a unique interview process. And so initially the interview process, there is a fit component that Helena mentions. And so you can prepare for those questions. They're typical questions. Tell me about a time you worked on a team or when you were a leader or when you had difficulty working with someone. So you can study for those, and you definitely should. But the unique part of consulting interviews is they all have a case component. And so case component actually is a real case the consulting firm probably worked on. And so you're in there with an interviewer, they provide you with data, and you sort of go through solving the problem and come to a recommendation for the client. And you do this in real time. There's mental math involved. You're sort of thinking on your feet. You're constantly being challenged. And the truth is you have to prepare for that. To think that you can sort of just walk in and do it without preparation would lead you to failure. I'm confident in saying that. Yes.
Yeah, and I would say don't get too bogged down in memorizing all the frameworks. Yeah. Find a general one that works for you and that you can potentially apply to every situation, or at least that's what I did. And then you can always tailor it to the problem that they're asking you. But don't memorize 20 different frameworks. That just wouldn't work.
Yeah, I think to build on those two points, I think if I were to say the single most important thing that helped me the most during my interviews is remembering that consulting is a professional service.
Yep.
And you're dealing with people. So whether it's case interview segment or the personal experience interview, you're dealing with people, and you have to think that your interviewer is a client. So you want to show that you are capable of becoming a consultant. You are a consultant already. And you can show that by sharing your personal stories or by doing a case. And so the fundamental skills are definitely need to be there, but it's having that mindset, I think that really helped me.
Yeah, to Robert's point, your interviewer will be your advocate, right? After you're done interviewing with you, they're gonna say whether they would like to work for you or not. So I think Helena's point is really good. They have to want to work with you. Clearly you have to do well on the case, but there has to be some intangible. You have to imagine they're interviewing 50 PhDs in one day. So a lot of them will do well on the case. So how do you sort of stick out? And I think a lot of that is fit, which is what these guys mentioned. So I agree with that. So for activities that helped, I think we have a good spectrum of them. So we've all obviously been involved with the consulting club, and so I've been part of that for a couple of years, and that's tremendously helped me prepare. I also took a course at the School of Business at Cary to help prepare me for some of the business aspects of consulting, and I think that was helpful. And then I did these immersion programs for some of these firms over the summer. They do little 3-day immersion programs at BCG and Bain and McKinsey and Clearview, and I did a couple of those. And it sort of helps you stick out as an applicant, but also gives you a feel of what being a consultant is like. So I thought those were really valuable.
Yeah, I think things that I did, I also worked for a startup, which also gave me great stories to talk about in the interviews, and then interned for a venture capital firm, which again gave me great stories to talk about. So those two experiences helped.
Yeah, I think, I guess in my mind, I kind of think of it as a pathway. Unless you have previous business experiences,
yeah.
I think most people are kind of starting from the ground zero. And so you have to first read information and gain those knowledge. And then after that, you can start maybe practicing through case competitions or just cases with friends. And those are kind of the no-risk environment where you can just learn more about business and consulting in general. After that, I think, for me, the real best experiences were the internship and the pro bono projects that I did, and I think those are very important in getting insights into how to deal with real world clients. I think all of those would help.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, so I'm scared because doing something new and out of my comfort zone, but I think that's part of the fun, and I think it'll be challenging and fun moving to a new place, moving to a new city. But also I'm excited about, the thing about a PhD is you work on one problem for 6 years, and you definitely become an expert in the area. But I'm excited to work on something for 6 weeks and then learn something new and move on to something and have a real terminal point and really deliver impact is what I'm excited about.
Yeah, I'm excited to work on different projects and have a faster turnaround time on projects, and then working with people with from different backgrounds. And I'm sure it'll be a steep learning curve, but I'm really excited about that too.
Right, I think I very much echo their points. I think for me, the most exciting thing to look forward to is the exposure that we'll be getting to different industries, different functions within those industries, and different people that I'll be working with. I think having focused on very narrow projects in my PhD for 6 years now, mm-hmm. I think it would be a real chance to be on that pace and work on challenging but impact-driven projects.